watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Get ready to find hope. Get ready to be inspired. Get ready to discover your full potential. Get ready for total success. From the Total Success Coach, Princess Bola Adelani.
Hi, this is Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, welcoming you to Inspired Success, your monthly dose of inspiration power, the program that equips you with the power and inspiration for total success. That is success at work and in life. It's June. Hallelujah. Voila. It's that month of the year. That month of the year when we absolutely just honor our men. Father's Day month, and on Inspired Success, we're no different. We follow the national calendar in America, and we also honor our men on Inspired Success. We do a show just for men, for fathers, for brothers. And I am so thrilled today. I am so excited today because with me in the studio to talk about what makes men tick. And maybe not quite tick, is a diverse panel of dynamic, motivated, successful men. Yes, ladies are all excited. I've got 5 men with me in the studio today. And we're going to be talking seriously, we're going to be talking about really what makes men tick and not so tick in all spheres of life, professionally, personally, and spiritually. You know, there's been this talk about, you know, men are from Mars and women are from Venus. And there's been a lot of research that's been done about how we interact, how we relate. Are we so different from one another? Are we 2 different species from 2 different planets? Is that the reason why we cannot get along? You know, I mean, the statistics, unfortunately, are very staggering and very sad. I would say that 60% of marriages end in divorce. Not only that, 60% of second marriages also end in divorce. And then, you know, the funny thing is that 96 or 97% of single men and women want to be in relationship with somebody. So what's that? What does that say? We cannot seem to get along, yet we don't want to stay apart either. And so we really want to kind of have this conversation, really much needed conversation, the goal being to improve our relationships, improve how we relate and interact with one another, you know, at work and also in life, you know. And so I have in the studio, like I said earlier, a very dynamic man. You guys know that I deal with the best and the brightest. You know, Princess Bola doesn't bring anybody. You know what I'm saying? So I have these really cool men with me in the studio. Some of them are second-time guests. They're no stranger to Inspired Success. And so I just would like you to please join me in welcoming Steve Adler to Inspired Success.
Glad to be here.
He's our town councillor in West Hartford, a really, really dynamic man. And of course, Mark, I was saying to Mark earlier, I said I should, you know, really kind of set up a show for Mark now, because this is like his 3rd time on this show. Do like a Dr. Phil Oprah kind of thing for him, right? Because he's becoming a guru motivator, but he's a great friend of mine, a really, really dynamic professional man. And Mark, it's great to have you back on Inspired Success.
Thank you.
And of course, seated next to Mark is a very young, up-and-coming professional man, a man of God, none other than Christopher Acosta. Thank you so much, Christopher, for being here. And of course, this is my colleague, seated right opposite me, a life coach, a very dynamic and inspirational man with a compelling life story. So really, you know, both professionally, this is somebody you really want to connect with to help you really navigate life and all of that. Dallas Sear, thank you for being on Inspire Success. And lastly, and definitely not least, is Dominic Perez from New Haven, Connecticut. Thank you so much, guys, for being here. It's my honor to have you on Inspired Success. So we're going to dive straight into this conversation. And I want us to begin by really, you know, you giving me your feedback and your thoughts on this question of women are from Mars and men are from Venus. Are we so different? Are we so different? Is it that we're from different planets, we're different species, and maybe that's the reason why we don't seem to kind of get along? Anybody wanna start that conversation?
I'll jump in. And I think men and women are different, and I think, you know, they may be from Mars or Venus, but what have you. But I think, you know, what we're trying to do collectively together, men and women, is really try to get along, whether it's in the workplace, whether it's in a social setting. And I think a lot of it is just being much more active listeners, being much more understanding, not necessarily just tolerant, but being understanding of other people's perspective. And, okay, you know, I figured I'd just kind of jump out and
okay, so you know. For you, really, you're saying you don't think it's so much that we're so different or speak a different language per se, or we're a different species, but it's more a communication thing that, you know, we're really coming to understand, you know, who we are and how we're kind of wired, which is what this show is really all about.
Yeah,
really,
and I think it's just not only communication, but I think it's mutual respect.
Yeah.
You could have communication, but if you really don't respect the other person and really take the time to get to know the other person and their position, it's just not going to work out, whether it's in marriage, whether it's in the workplace, in the social setting. So,
okay, absolutely, absolutely. And that's why we're doing this show today, because we want to really understand what really makes men tick, you know. Women want to understand. And then it's important, too, for men to understand that. You know, some people haven't really come to a place where they are aware of who they are. Mm-hmm. You know, how are you wired as a man? What really make, you know, some of you may have not given thought to that. And I really suggest that you do. You know, I think it's a thought-provoking question. What makes me tick as a man, you know, really? And that goes to how I'm wired, you know, what are my likes, what are my dislikes, was my forte, was not my forte, you know. It's really important for you to really define that and understand who you are first before you can really be in successful relationship with anybody else, or even succeed at life at all. So what say you? What say you, Dallas? I see Dallas really
that's a big part of my own personal philosophy, is that the better that you know yourself, the more in depth that you can go with who you are, why you think the way you think, not just on a surface level that, you know, I like music, or I like sports, or I like, you know, a specific type of person, but even to go a little bit deeper and just try to discover why that is. I think the better that you know that, the better you'll be aware of your surroundings. The more likely you are to attract someone that fits you the way that you need to be fit. I think your coworkers, you'll magnetize to the proper coworker in your workspace and be more attractive to everybody around you, not just women. So I think that's a huge point.
People
need to do that.
So guys, you want to really kind of be following this conversation,
sure,
and kind of looking inwards and reflecting on that. Well, because these guys are sharing.
Because that's something women do naturally.
Yes.
And I think that, you know, guys are starting to do that more.
Yes.
But definitely.
Absolutely.
Where I could grow.
So follow the conversation then. So are we different? Are we fundamentally different? You know, that we're so totally from different planets.
I think to some degrees we are.
Okay.
You know, there's no doubt about that. You know, was it John Gray's book, of which, mm-hmm, I think we've all probably read. If you haven't, you should read it. But I think to the point of what we're trying to get at today, kind of like what Stephen Dallas were mentioning, is in order to figure out how to get along in the workplace, how to figure out, you know, not necessarily, because a lot of times at workplace, people want to get ahead. Yeah. Or they want to do these things, and that becomes conniving and things. But if you could just take a step back for a second and kind of determine the essence of who you are, ask yourself the right questions, not the wrong questions. A lot of people ask themselves the wrong questions. They go, what do I like? You know, instead of, what am I living for?
Yes, who am I?
Right, who am I? What drives me?
Yes.
And, you know, because a lot of things drive people, money,
absolutely,
you know, success, you know, different types of topics. However, you got to say, well, what drives me as a person? Not these action verbs or these, you know, sort of other sort of superficial sort of things, but what on a soul level, what on an essence level, you know, kind of what am I living for? You know, because everyone likes something,
yes,
you know, and they say, well, gosh, you know, if it's in a relationship, well, the girl likes this or, you know, and I like that.
Yeah.
Well, that's wonderful. But when you're living together, you know, for a long time, it better be some sort of common life goal. There better be some common path, some one, not two, yellow brick roads that leads to Oz.
Yeah.
You know, that sort of thing. So it really defines, first off, you have to ask yourself the right questions versus the superficial questions. I'm like, what do I like? But more of, who am I? What really motivates me in life, and how do I envision my life? You know, and that could be a multitude of things, but I think it starts there.
Absolutely, I agree. I mean, and so that's the foundation. I think the foundation is, we've agreed that the foundation is, first of all, you define who you are first, and try and get to the core of who you are on the inside and your authentic self and what really drives you, what motivates you, really what are your values, what do you like and what do you not like. And then when we take that to the next level, the next question will be, Christopher, are we so different? Mark says we are different. But what say you?
I think it's important to think back to the start of human history, the start of mankind. You know, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, Scripture says, and he made man and woman in his image and in his likeness. So both men and women, you know, are equal in dignity, worth, and value, although they do play different roles. And so I think understanding that, plays a big role in the way we live lives together, the way we function in relationships, in marriages, and in community. And so I just think that's an important thing to keep in mind.
I totally agree with you on that. You know, that when we come to understand the whole purpose of why we coexist, you know, why we are here together on this planet, mm-hmm. and we understand that we are a team, we're partners, we're designed to complement each other. Really, woman, they say, is a womb man. Womb men. The only difference really is that she has a womb, mm-hmm. and you guys don't, you know? And so, but there's still men and men in that, in all of that structure. So I agree with you that essentially we're the same, and essentially our desires and our goals and our, you know, our worth and all of that is the same. We all want to live successful lives. We want to be happy. We want to live in harmony. We want to be fruitful. We want to be successful. All that innate desires is common to both men and women, you know. So I would say we're the same side, different sides of the same coin, mm-hmm. and that we are partners, and we're here to complement each other and not compete. Mm-hmm. And that I would say that, like Steve was saying, that you know, perhaps it's more a question of coming to understand why we're both here on this planet, sure. and coming to respect each other as team, as equals, as people kind of going like Mark was saying, on that same path. And what would you say to that, Dominic?
I agree with Steve as well.
Yeah.
A lot about the communication part of it, just trying to get to know each other and convey the messages back and forth. And that's just not even just with women, but anybody. Like, just taking it from home and then using that on the women that you meet out in the world is just like, it's a big difference.
Okay, and that is why what we are doing today, and you know, you can join this conversation on Facebook, Twitter. I mean, just join this conversation. I think it's an overdue conversation. It's a conversation we need to have constantly, you know, right. to really improve our communities, to improve our nation, ultimately improve, because when the improvement starts, you know, at the family unit and that individual unit, it kind of then spreads to the workplace, spread to the community, and then, you know, it just kind of goes there. You know, we want to really get to the root today on inspired success, on what makes men tick, what makes them tick, cannot tick. So ladies, you're taking notes. Guys, you're saying to yourself, really, let me find out who I really am today, you know? And so we have sorted that out. We said we are kind of the same, you know, with same goals, same desires, same philosophies, you know, trying to reach the same goals, really, basically, and we're a team. And so now let's begin to understand, okay, from a man's perspective, you know, we're honoring them for Father's Day. What makes men tick?
You know, first of all, I think what makes me tick from a man's perspective is really living your life with passion, being passionate through compassion. And, and you know, in terms of being passionate about something, you know, or many things, and it's just not going to work. It could be about, you know, giving back to the community. It could be about, you know, participating in your religious groups. But I really think that, you know, life's really short. I have a cousin who just recently, not to bring down the group, but who recently passed away at 49. And, you know, God gives you so many days on earth, and you really have to be passionate about something, just like you are with this program and even outside this program. As far as, you know, being passionate, it's also about being compassionate as well. And I really think it is, you know, to the opposite sex, when I'm working with a female, and I work for a great organization, we have a lot of female leadership in our organization, I don't approach, you know, the day-to-day by going, well, there's a female who happens to be 10 pay grades above me. I look at it as, well, look at the skills and look at the leadership qualities that this person brings. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, again, I think people, you know, years ago, you know, men were considered the hunters and the women the gatherers. Well, those roles have completely changed.
Yes.
And I think the sooner men kind of embrace that, and I think Dallas, I'm not sure if it was Dallas or Chris had mentioned that women are essentially smarter than men in that area, that they get it, and we have to kind of work at it.
Yes.
And I think a good example of that would be, you know, the annual sexual harassment training that we have to go through. Mm-hmm. And the reason why we have that is because, you know, we had some stupid men who really did some bad behaviors.
Yes.
And now we have this regulatory requirement where it says we can't put our hands on the women that we work with. Well,
yeah.
You know, it's common sense, but unfortunately.
I know.
So that's kind of a mouthful,
I mean, that you've hit it. I mean, you've touched on so many things there. Number one, you know, you're saying, you know, show some passion for your work. Mm-hmm. You know, show some passion for really your work. And then you talked about the skill set. So you're saying that as a leader, as a manager, you don't look at it from a gender perspective when you're at work, but you're saying, you know, this person has honed their skills, they deliver, and all of that. So there's no excuse, you know, based on gender, the female complex, okay, sisters, that I'm a woman and all of that, and so the expectation is less, or the bar needs to be raised a little lower for me, you know, that kind of thing. So that's what I hear you say, that really and truly, when you meet a woman at work who delivers at the same level of professionalism and expertise and excellence as a man, then you get the respect.
I think if you take a look from personal or professional experience, I think if you take a look at, you know, our culture, and if you take a look at our level of engagement at work, you know, a lot of it, I think, is driven from the leadership who happen to be female.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's, you know, by coincidence. I think they get it. We need to understand that, and we need to figure out how to embrace that without killing ourselves.
Yes.
You know?
And so, for you guys, because there's still some guys who are very kind of old school watching this show, okay, who are thinking, you know, when you perceive your perception of women and, you know, where their place are in the workplace, you know, you kind of, you know, associate their women, their gender with the kitchen and the bedroom and, you know, those kind of things, you know. So maybe perhaps you're watching this show today, mm-hmm. and that's what makes you tick. And you're thinking at work, you're only seeing a woman from, you know, the outward exterior of how she's built and all of that. And not really kind of looking to her intellect and who she is on the inside and what she can deliver. I think you should kind of be shifting now, right? Your mindset and so on. So, and what do you say as well? I know you work with a lot of women.
Yeah, well, I want to just continue on your point. because if men do think that way,
yeah,
you know, they're in for a rude awakening with their own career, right? As in the same way that, you know, you see successful marriages,
yeah,
you know, who wears the boots, you know? I mean, let's just face it. You know, who controls the social calendar on the weekends? You know, these types of things. In the office, though, you know, I've dealt with two women today who I highly respect, you know, who also do the same job that men do in their respected opinion. One was an attorney, one was a wholesaler.
Yeah.
And I respect them both very much. So the reason why is because, to use Steve's word, they do have a compassion for what they do. They have a compassion for helping, making a difference. Yes. And if you can do that, that is how somebody gets ahead. They don't even think about it. You know, it's just through the dichotomy of what how people operate within the workplace. And that's men and women.
Yes.
However, being that we're talking about women, both of those, I actually told one of them today because I think she was feeling a little bit on the sense of, gosh, I'm a woman, it's harder to get ahead. And I said, do you realize how much people actually respect you for the work that you do? And not only that, the divine energy that you bring to your work. And we really had this conversation today. It's odd that we're sitting here today, but it's a perfect example. So I think that there needs to be a paradigm shift. If men are truly thinking what you just said, I think they have to have a paradigm shift to understand there could be some wonderful conversation at work. There could be to bring the corporation ahead if they're in a corporate environment. But no matter who it is, if you say, who do you like working with, who, the ones that bring the light. I stay away from the ones that bring the dark. You surround yourself with energy, right?
Exactly.
And then I say that, you know, I'm not saying necessarily religiously, but there's an energy of positive and there's an energy of negative, hence a battery. Yeah. I tend to lean towards the people and gravitate towards them, and those people gravitate towards you if you have a positive mindset. And I think we all would agree on that in our workplace, and I think the listeners would agree. But are you possessing that? Are you a proponent of that? And are you accepting of when other people are?
Exactly. So now you've heard it now, really. But you know, the reason why that we're having this conversation and why a lot of women still, you know, kind of lack the esteem and they feel, you know, will I be successful is because of what the statistics are. You know, the statistics are saying that till date in America, 21st century America, that women still earn 77 cents to a dollar for men for equal work. You know, and so there is still, you know, that kind of discrimination. It's not a level playing field at all. And so, you know, that is why I wanted women to understand that you will rise up that corporate ladder. You will do well in your career if you hone your skills and you don't allow your gender to be an obstacle in your mind. You know, you've heard it. Deliver, hone your skill set. Do your work with passion and excellence. You know, bring in a positive mindset. Don't take work, don't take home to work, you know, and things like that. And you will do well. And you will, if you're working with men, and like they say that really the marketplace is still dominated, they say it's a men's world, then you will still find that you will still be able to rise and to set yourself apart and really shine. I mean, I know you are working, you work in a nonprofit. Yes. And I know personally that your mom is in leadership, you know, and all of that. Yeah. And you probably work with other.
Yeah, I mean, working in church, you know, holding to a Judeo-Christian worldview, you know, I look to Jesus as my role model for how he treated women, to how to treat women, and much of how I've personally learned. To coexist and in relationship, in community, has been primarily through my mother. I also have a younger sister.
So what makes
working,
you
working,
what,
yeah, working in the workplace, yeah, what working you, in the workplace the with older women, with younger women, with teenagers, being that I run the youth ministry.
Yeah.
I deal with females of all types of ages and all types of personal issues. And very difficult issues. I've seen some very, you know, hard things, challenging issues in life. And for me, holding to the Judeo-Christian worldview and looking to Jesus as my role model and holding a respect for women, you know, everything doesn't have to be all sexually charged up and there doesn't have to be that tension. You know, for me, I have a younger sister and I think someday I'll end up having, you know, children and if I have a daughter, and I think about that and I say, you know, well, I should be treating this young, beautiful woman as my sister or as I would treat my mother. You know what I mean? Can you go have a cup of coffee with your sister and enjoy some good time? Absolutely. Yeah. You know, it doesn't have to be so charged up. And so for me, you know, keeping that in mind, the relational aspect, you know, treating other females as I would treat my, you know, younger sister or my mother, you know, or family member, you know, it really kind of levels the playing field and kind of rids you of that sexual tension. And, you know what I mean? It keeps your eyes, you know, looking, you know, at their face from which the glory of God should shine rather than their body.
Okay. So I think you've touched on something on the, you know, and I want us to kind of go a little bit deeper now here because, okay, I want our viewers to learn. I want our viewers to learn. I want the women to learn that are watching the show today, you know, to understand our men better and understand what really makes them tick at work. So what are the doo-doos and don't-dos that, you know, exist, you know? And for the men, for the male viewers, for you to really kind of be looking inward and reflecting as we are having this conversation, you know, in terms of what makes me tick. So now, you've gone there. So, you know, what I hear you saying implicitly is that what does not make you tick is when you see too much of a woman, you know, in the at work, you know, and when that comes to our kind of dress etiquette, and sometimes I want to coach my female clients in terms of, you know, I mean, there's so much out there in popular culture that is not acceptable in the workplace, you know, kind of going for an interview or dressing and all of that, because I think that may be sending out the wrong signals affecting men in certain ways that you may not have intended.
There's different types of energy, just like there's different types of attention.
Yes.
And so you just have to determine what type of attention that you're expecting or looking for, and that should absolutely affect the way that you dress. Because when I am in the workplace, the two things that I'm looking at consistently is, one, the way that the person is dressed, be it male or female, but also eye contact. So if two of those things are strong, they're appropriate, and they convey that I'm looking for positive attention, then that's exactly
what you're
going to get.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, so that is...
And there's a way to do that and still be attractive and feminine.
Absolutely.
You don't have to not be a woman. You don't have to be a guy. Because one of the things I want to talk about, too, is the fact that we are different, men and women are different, but that's one of the best things that we should be celebrating is those differences. It's not a matter of just trying to figure it out, but just to celebrate and embrace the fact that you're different.
Yes, that we are different.
Absolutely.
And exactly.
I'm glad there's women out there, right?
Yes.
That's right. No, absolutely.
I say, you know, negative and negative, no power is produced.
Exactly.
Positive and negative need to get together for power to be released.
But the thing is, you do think differently.
Yes.
So if we're talking workplace, it's wonderful to be able to bring in the different ideas and the different angles with which people think, especially from a client perspective and what people might be thinking. So if we understand that, and as Chris said, we can get by the sexual tension that could be from a woman or a man's perspective,
because
that happens too, just as it gets talked about a lot, right?
Yes.
That if we can do that and we could accept each other as team players so that the men actually are interested. Because when you focus on something, the other stuff can disperse.
Disperse.
It can be. So if you're really focusing a task on hand and really doing the best job possible, so when you're talking to a woman in the manner like which I was doing today, really focusing on the client solutions and different things, you know, gender had nothing to do with it. And we were working collaboratively as team players to solve somebody's problem.
Exactly.
And it came from different angles that I might not have thought of.
Exactly.
And it lent to wonderful
the value that you bring to your clients. And that brings us to another kind of whole subject here, because you're going into the diversity in the workplace and the power of diversity and how diversity now, you know, makes just more than, you know, good social sense or being socially good. It makes good business sense when we have that diversity, gender, ethnoculturally, you know, where different perspectives and viewpoints can come to the table. It really enhances creativity and makes our delivery, customer service delivery just even so much better. Absolutely.
Agreed,
so,
yeah.
You know, I mean, we're touching on some phenomenal things, wouldn't you say today? Mm-hmm. I mean, what makes men tick? Join the conversation. Facebook, search for Princess Bola, Inspired Success TV, Twitter, follow our tweets, and just share your own views. Join that conversation, royalproclamations.com. You know, we want to improve our relationships at work and in life. And so we've talked professionally, and now I want us to talk socially. There are a lot of young, single guys here, you know, and so apart from Steve and I, you know, sorry, you know, my husband, I was saying to someone jokingly the other day, I was, you know, introducing me to some young guys, and he was jokingly saying about, you know, cougars and all of that. Like, ooh, look, my husband would literally put a gun in your head. Don't even go there. So apart from, and I'm sure, you're your wife the same. Yeah. So apart from the two of us, well, we are spoken for, but there are a lot of single guys here. And really, you know, like I was saying in my intro, that 97% of single men and women want to be in relationship, and that's why the match, what do they call it? The dating,
mm-hmm.
match.com and those dating sites and all of that. It's a $1 billion industry, $1 billion industry. So, I mean, you know, hey, this is freebie here now, okay? What socially, you know, we've left the workplace, you want to go, you're looking for a woman to date. I know you're single, you know. What kind of habits? What are the
back way?
Exactly. Don't go there.
Yeah. Go get me a drink.
Yeah. Do the contractual arrangements. You know, those penalties are very, very painful. So.
Can I
just make one comment, and then I'll let the rest of the free world talk. So, I happen to be a big Facebook fan.
Yes.
You know, and I never thought I would get into social media. And, you know, everyone, you know, there's the professional LinkedIn side, and then there's Facebook.
Yes.
And of course, my son says, whatever you do, Dad, do not Facebook me. Don't friend me, whatever you do. But I find that, you know, social media today really kind of helps you get through, you know, some of the social mores and allows you to talk about things. And I think, as you said, Dallas, outside of the sexual conversations, you know, around social, around political discussions, around other things like that.
Yes.
And I think, you know, social media gives you that kind of venue without having to have all the gender tension,
yes,
tension around that.
True, to some extent.
Sure.
But there's some things I see too on social media that, you know, for me, it's a put off, you know,
right,
doesn't make me tick, even as a woman, you know, so, but
I'm not familiar with those, so,
you know, there are a few kind of posts and things there, but, you know, let's talk face to face. You're single guys, you know, you're, you know, thinking of dating, you know, down the line, you want to meet a woman, you're out socially at a party, at an event, you know, a social event, mm-hmm, and all of that. So what kind of things that, you know, women do that would, you know, make you tick and not quite tick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I just wanted to comment on what you were saying before, just giving some statistics. In this nation, you know, 91%, you know, will eventually at some point get married.
Yeah.
And I think if most men tap their deepest desires, you know, it's to be in relationship with, you know, a significant other. And I believe, you know, that's in our nature, that God has given us that. I mean, you see that type of, you know, desire for relationship within the Trinity of the God. And so, I don't know, you know, just thinking about dating, male dating, and what we look for, dealing with teenagers, you know, I'm kind of a history buff a little bit. And, you know, thinking about dating, how it's affected our nation and in our culture, you know, the word dating itself, I believe, entered the English vernacular in 1896 as a synonym for the word prostitution, which is really strange and interesting.
Really?
Because you have, from that time into the early 1900s, you have, you know, women starting women magazines and, you know, kind of redefining, you know, what it means to be, you know, a woman rather than having family and faith defining that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, think about it. You go to your local grocery store, your checkout line, you have these magazines, they're dedicated to women, and some of the headings on these magazines are I mean, awful. 10 things to do in bed, you know, to make your boyfriend happy. Not one of them, you know, is read the Bible.
It's really godless.
And then you have the 1920s. You know, you have restaurants, movie theaters, dance halls, popularizing and becoming more common, and dating is no longer done in the community of the home. You have people congregating elsewhere outside of the home. The 1930s, automobile sales, you know, increase. It becomes more common to buy cars. You have young men, instead of, you know, going to court a young lady at her house under the supervision and safety of her family and parents, they're now picking them up and taking them out. The 1940s, young men begin to realize that, wow, this dating stuff is, you know, quite costly. You know, I have to buy some new clothes. You know, I have to buy her flowers. I have to pay for dinner. You know, get a clean shave, a haircut. It's rather interesting because you have these young men paying all this money to do these things. They start realizing, like, wow, this is costing me a lot of money. You know, then there's these expectations when they take these young ladies out on dates. It's like, hey, I paid for all this stuff. You know, I think I deserve something, which is essentially, you know, in a form of prostitution. And then you have, you know, you jump to the 1960s with the feminism and sexual revolution embracing this form of dating. You know, also in the 1960s, Playboy made its first, you know, magazine, made it to, you know, the counter, behind the counter for sale. Pornography became legalized. Gay rights movement started. The 1970s, you have, you know, the creation of birth control, which now allows women to date, you know, to go around and to not have the risk of pregnancy, which also leads to abortion, which also leads to, you know, the legalization of no strings attached type marriage, no fault type marriage. And then, you know, you go on and you have the film industry, you know, media. And I'm just saying, like, all of these things are a culmination, it's a culmination of, you know,
brought us to a place now. It's redefined
if I could say it this way. It's redefined and reshaped, you know, dating, you know, how we conduct relationships between
socially,
men and
yes.
women in the dating scene.
Okay,
It's very common to us, though, and it's because we're born into it. But in light of history, you know, it's very new, it's very recent, it's very strange and very godless. I mean, all of it together works together as a revolt against, you know, cultural, against, it's like a, all of it works together as a revolt against, you know, conservative, godly values in a way. Because you have the dating scene now, which is very aggressive, as you were saying, Facebook. It's very aggressive and it's very perverted. Right now on Craigslist, you have an average of like 1,500 people advertising for a casual encounter.
Okay, now I'm going to just stop you right there because you touched on something that one of my, you know, viewers was saying to me when I was telling her I was doing this show, what does makes men tick? And she said, oh, come on, Princess Bola, that's a one-minute show. Three words, S-E-X, you know.
right.
And then I'm like, really? You know, but I mean, you've really very well expounded how we have come to the place where we are.
Yeah.
So is it really true, though, that for most men socially, when it comes to social encounters, you know, that what makes them tick, the expectation, the ultimate expectation is they want to get back into the bedroom with a girl. Would that be right? Is it that most men are driven only by that?
I would just add one
would
quick
you say?
Comment. Is, you know, looking at, talk to me.
Well, say yes or no.
No, I don't think so. You know
for
I mean?
You personally,
me
no.
Me personally, no. I mean,
no.
When I go out and I meet a girl, I try to read her and see what it is that she wants, you know, rather than, okay, well, I'm trying to do this or I'm trying to do that. I try not to keep my expectations too high just because she may be really low and, you know what I'm saying, maybe she just wants to have sex, you know what
yes.
I'm saying? But for me personally, I try to look out and I try to find a girl who's classy, you know, who's nice and honest and just a respectful person in general.
Not exactly. So that's not what drives you. Really.
No, not at all.
And I think that women have this misconception and that somehow also they put that pressure on men, even young men growing up, you know, that is supposed to be what it is. And so they send out all those signals as well. But I'm meeting a lot of men who, you know, privately are saying to me, you know what, you know, that's not what I'm kind of looking for, really. I'm looking for more depth and more, you know, more to come to the table and all of that. And for some men, actually, that is a put off.
Sure.
You know, yeah. I don't know. What would you say?
I think you got both sides of the coin.
Yes.
Right? You've got, and I think it, you know, based on the history of what you're saying, it all depends where you come from on how you make your decisions in life. Everyone's got a foundation to their human house of who they are.
Yes.
And so when you make your decision on what, you know, paint you're going to put on and what, it's all how you make your decisions in life is what foundation of who you are as a person, you know. But then with men, you know, there are the physicality, there are the hormones, the different things, especially at a younger age.
Yes.
So they fight more morality with physical. Right, yes. And so they have this contradiction going on.
Absolutely. Yes. If I had this conversation when I was 18, it'd be a very different answer.
It'd be a 1 minute conversation.
Yeah, it really would be. She'd be right about
it. She'd be right.
She'd be like, all right, Dallas, thanks for coming.
Thanks,
But it is. So it kind of depends, you know. So I say it's give and take. I think society has a lot to do with it. I completely agree with Chris. When you see these billboards driving down the street, you know, with the VIP, constantly in your face, that triggers the juices, that triggers things. So then guys go, oh, I got to go do this, I got to go do that. And they use it as, and I think this is a key word, acceptable in society.
Yes.
You know, it's now the norm.
It's become a social
norm. It's become a norm and acceptable.
Yes.
So as, you know, as I got older, you know, I'm 41 now.
Yeah.
So as I got older, what's really made me is how I kind of figured out, you're saying what makes me tick as a young professional, you know, in my early 40s, is really understanding what I now want out of life, which way I'm gonna go, and then how I make my decisions on that front. I am on the dating sites, Princess. I was IMing the other night.
Absolutely.
You know, and these other things. But my questions and where I am now are different.
Absolutely.
Right?
So you're now saying that what I hear you say, and ladies, I want you to really catch that, is you get to a point as you grow older where it's your values that begin to drive you. You know, even socially, your values kind of drive you.
It drives your decision
socially,
making.
Yeah, your decision making. And what really will make you tick is in terms of when you come across a woman socially who, you know, carries herself well, who's classy, like you said, who can talk intellectually, who can deliver, and who seem to be going somewhere that you are also wanting to go out of life. And that's what drives you. And it's not really more as sexual as maybe we think, you know,
but
because
women,
secretly, you know.
Yeah, women need to be able to figure that out. And I think that's the dichotomy that they're going through and the challenge they go through. They need to understand, I mean, how many times have we heard it as from our friends who might be female and be like, oh, I went out with this guy and, you know, he was great, but he treated me like dirt and he did this. And then, you know, they put on this fake act.
Yeah.
So women, if you want to understand how men tick, you got to understand that. So you got to be able to figure it out. They all say they want a nice guy, but do they really?
Yes,
right. Of course,
yes.
Of course,
it's not,
they do.
Not by chance that they attract all the dirtbags.
So, but it does. Everything that we do shapes who we are, and they have to just kind of figure that out. So but they can if you stop and analyze, you know, your moral character, your moral values, and make your decision, and actually say no, maybe to an attractive guy, or find something else attractive that might not be physical.
Yes.
And men too should do the same thing in women.
Yes.
That's the point I'm at. So that's what makes me tick.
I work with tons of young female teenagers, and you know, just hearing them out and looking at, you know, what their focus is, it's so influenced by social media, mainstream media, whether it be music, television, movies, and it's really shaping, you know, the way they perceive relationships. And it's really sad because you have so many young men who are in high school, and I hear the conversations. I mean, they're not much different from when I was in high school, but I mean, it seems that for them, the dating mentality, the relational mentality, when they approach women is, you know, hook up, shack up, break up, repeat. You know, just keep doing it over and over again. There's no concept, you know, of morality. Like you were saying, how men seem to, you know, in our older stages, you know, we seem to kind of, in finding ourselves, begin to find our values
mature.
And morals. Yeah, mature. And
so the other didn't work.
Yeah, one of the two.
You know, so
exactly.
Our job is to teach the young. And I like what you do.
So that's
he
what,
tries to
you know,
teach
and so
the
for
young.
Me, teaching the young means, you know, dating, relationship, you know, instead of dating to score, you should be dating to marry. You know, marriage, dating, it should be one man, one woman, one marriage,
with
one
a
lifetime.
Commitment, with a sense of exactly. a commitment, exactly. And you know, and you really touch when you talk relationship, relationally, you know, socially. I look at that, especially younger generation. Really, a lot of pressure, mm-hmm. both on the men and the women, because they've got the whole concept. Absolutely. Of what we're, how we're supposed to interact socially wrong. Mm-hmm. And I find that a lot of women just compromise sometimes and they settle for what they think is supposed to, they're supposed to do,
exactly.
not because they really want to. And the same with the men, and they just do it because it's the norm. But you've got it today, you know, really and truly, because when you begin to settle like that, you really begin to diminish at the core of who you are, mm-hmm. and ultimately robs you of your esteem and your sense of worth and self.
Sure.
You know, when you keep running like that, you know, Jersey Shore might be fun, but really in reality, when you go through all of that, you begin to chip away at the core of who you are and really lose a sense of self and esteem. And so you've heard it from guys here saying today that really when it comes socially, really, they're not looking for that. It's not just about that. Three-letter word, you know, mm-hmm. it's not all about that. There's more that they're expecting from you. So, ladies, hey, you step up, you know, and raise the bar and put your head back mm-hmm. and carry yourself with dignity and say that I'm worth more than just being, you know, shack up, rack up, or whatever, and break up, you know. I'm worth more than that, okay?
Exactly.
And so, you know, that's a really, 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 really huge one for us to pass across today. And then for guys, I know maybe there's some younger viewers who are watching today and all of that. You know, like I said, this show is going to help you to begin to really reflect and look inwards. Who really are you? What are your values? Even as a young guy of 15, 13, you know, growing up, take time after this show and step aside and spend 5 minutes by yourself and really can begin to ask yourself these questions. You know, you're not too young to start asking yourself questions like that. And that is why I'm very passionate. I do this program every year for girls and young women in the fall, you know, and as I was reflecting on my theme for this year, conference, which, by the way, I'd like you to save the date. The second annual Total Woman Conference for Girls and Young Women is on November 12th, 2011. Go to my website, royalproclamations.com, for more information. But, you know, as I was reflecting on that, I said to myself, you know, I want to, the theme of the conference will be centered around a book I'm writing, The Power Bridges to Destiny, you know, and realizing from an early age that you have a destiny, mm-hmm. that you have a unique destiny of your life of greatness, and that you're not just there, you're not just part of, you know, the statistics and just, you know, you're somebody unique and special who can make a true difference. Mm. And so you're a teenager, you're a young adult watching this show today as a bloke, and you're, you know, you can step aside and begin to ask yourself those questions. Who am I? And where am I going? And what do I really want out of life? What kind of life do I want? And when you look deep, deep down within you, each and every one of us want one thing. We want to be successful. We want to be happy. We want to be fulfilled. We want to live a good life. That is at the core of who we are. You know, that is an innate hunger we'll all have. And you can begin to now map out your life now from this moment and say, you know what? I won't settle because this is where I'm going. I won't settle. This is my values. And I'm going to attract the same kind of person into my life. Mm-hmm. You know, so because, and that is what eventually you will find that you will be able to attract that kind of person who will be a partner to you, who would help you, because two, they say, is better than one, mm-hmm. to help you to reach your ultimate goal and your ultimate dreams. I mean, this is just a really, really exciting conversation here. I mean, so we've talked professionally, we've talked socially. Today, you're watching Inspired Success if you just tuned in. And I have this diverse panel with Steve and with Mark and with Christopher and with Dallas and with Dominique, and we're talking about what makes men tick and not tick, and our goal, as usual, on Inspired Success, our goal is to equip you with the power and inspiration for total success, which is work-life success. I really want you to be successful at work and in life. And I mean, if you're not successful in your relationships, hey, you're no success at all, because life is all about relationships. Mm. So we've been talking about, you know, what makes men tick at work. And, you know, the resounding thing that everyone has been saying here today is that men are ticked by, you know, intelligence, by passion, by positive energy, by good women, you know, and less by, you know, their body parts, you know. So there is more. And as we close, I'd like you to just, you know, share your closing thoughts with our viewers in terms of when you are, when you in a relationship, are in a relationship with someone, what are the habits, what are the things that make you tick and not tick? You're already in that relationship, okay? And what are the things, you know, I know what my husband says to me sometimes, you know, but what are the some of the things that you're in that relationship? Because some of these things are the root of our of the divorce, high divorce rates and our breakups, you know. So you are as a man in a relationship, you've been in there, we just recently heard that Maria Shriver and Arnold are breaking up after 25 years, mm-hmm. okay? So obviously something else was making him tick, you mm-hmm. know? And so we see the results of that, you know? But, you know, really seriously, what in that relationship makes you tick or not tick when you're with your significant other? I know some of you are in relationships with, you know, married or engaged or mm-hmm. what have you, and or have been in the past. What kind of thing would really make you think, you know, I love this woman, I just want to spend the rest of my life with her? Or, you know, the next day, like I say sometimes, it's a roller coaster. Someday I wake up and my husband is just, oh my goodness, this is Jesus. Oh, he's an angel, he's so sweet. And the next day I'm like, who are you? The devil's, you know what I mean? You're the devil's younger brother here, you know? So there are days and we have moments and all that, but generally, you know, there's something that keeps bringing you back to that person, to that relationship, and keeps attracting you to a certain type of woman, or keeps you involved and keeps you staying on. Well, what would that be for you?
To keep me staying involved, I mean, I'm real big on respect from women, like, because I try to give it as well as much as I ask for it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, even with my previous relationship, I actually just got out of one, so I'm not one of the guys that are involved right now. But
Why did you get out, if I may ask you, too directly?
I mean, was it you? I can roll out a scroll for all the reasons, but
give me one thing that really was eventually like, okay, no, this is totally does not make me tick, and I'm not going on.
There was no respect coming from either side, no trust. There was just nothing anymore.
Okay, good. What about you, Dallas? Because we have only 5 minutes. Can you believe it? I mean, how time flies. And we're really roasting in the studio today, as you can see, all of us kind of sweating because the air conditioning broke. So you have to say a big, big thank you to my guests. They're just the best, really, for agreeing to stay on for 60 minutes. And, you know, we're all kind of sweating here. And I was jokingly saying, you know, that's all my taxes. Thank God for West Hartford, you know.
There's only three of us. You want to talk to the other. You all
that's
talk
why
to
he's sitting
the
next
other guy,
to you.
Yeah. That's politics, sir. You know.
So anyway, but we're not going there. No, it's actually a great town to live in. We're number 7 in the nation, best town to live in. Sure. It's just that our studio, the air conditioner breaks at the time we need it. But anyway, that aside. So joke, more seriously now, for you, just one thing, because we're wrapping up. And don't forget, the conversation continues. royalproclamations.com. I have a forum there. Inspire Success TV is on Facebook. You know, I really want us to get this conversation going, because honestly, I really believe that if we can really learn truly how we're both wired, you know, both genders are wired, and we can really understand ourselves better, like Steve was saying at the beginning of the broadcast, that we'll really, really, really be living a better world ultimately, you know. So you tell me, you're in relationship with someone, what would make you tick, and what would be like, you know?
It's confidence. Because I need to be able to have my own space, my own time, without the fear or lack of trust that says, what is it that you're doing? How come we can't be together? Because any relationship I've ever been in where the person needs to be there with you at all times, it shows a lack of trust, a lack of confidence, and it makes me very uncomfortable. Yeah. So if we can have our own space, but when we're together, it's still beautiful. Then
Okay, so don't be so clingy. And women sometimes are guilty of that. What would you say would one thing will be for you, will make you tick, and one that will be like, no, go, don't go there kind of thing?
One that makes me tick? I would like to quote a dear friend of mine who says, a girl should get so lost in God that a male or a man has to seek him to find her.
Okay.
And I would say that is the number one thing, because that's going to affect morals. It's going to keep you on the same page.
Yes, absolutely.
And it's going to keep you going to have the same end goal as you were saying.
Yes, absolutely. So that will make you take a really deep spiritual girl who fears God and loves God. Absolutely. Amen to that. Amen. And for you, the same? Because you've been asking all the Jewish girls in West Hartford.
Single.
Single, of course.
Which is
so formidable. And he's a nice bloke, you know. That's why I keep bringing him back.
Yeah, as long as they're Jewish, they feed me grapes and fan me. I think
nice.
No. I think what it is for me, is that we build each other's self-esteem.
Okay.
You know, to me, it's not a one-way street. It's not what I just need. I need to be able to build their self-esteem, so when we're having bad days, that we know that the external world is the external world. Work is work, but it's not life.
I get it.
Right? So when we come home, there's that smile. We're happy to be around.
Encouragement.
For a better life's path, that we don't limit ourselves to just the external things, as we were talking about. Sure. This might sound a little cheesy, but to the external things of society that make no sense.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. We have only 1 minute, and
all right,
then
I'll
sum
up my
years.
I'll sum up my 25 years of marriage in 1 minute. So really, it's about, and this is strictly the comments around marriage. It's really a work in process, and it's about having patience. It's about understanding and having perspective. And
so that one thing for you, one thing that really would make you tick or not tick is what?
Is really respect.
Respect.
Is having mutual respect for one another.
Absolutely. I mean, you've heard it. Honestly, we could write a book on this show. Don't you think? Very, very, very great information here. Tips, tools, and strategies for your total success. It's been inspired success, and I want to say a big, big, big thank you to my... these guys are just amazing too, right? Really, really dynamic panel. A big thank you to you, Steve, Mark, Christopher, Dallas, and Dominique. And of course to you, my viewers, for tuning in to Inspire Success. Like I've been saying throughout the show, you can join the conversation at Facebook, royalproclamations.com. I am looking forward to seeing you next month. Next month is our Embracing Change Summer Challenge, where we are challenging you to enhance your physical power, and I'll be bringing my Change Power team also on the broadcast, so you can look forward to that. And it's Princess Bola Adelani, the Total Success Coach, reminding you to keep smiling. Hey, come on, put a smile on your face. Life's too short. You know what I'm saying? Keep believing, keep learning, and keep on keeping on. I'll see you next month. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless.